For those of you lucky enough to be running a Mac, you may want to check out Screencasts Online. You'll find that Don McAllister produces a series of excellent tutorial screencasts where you can learn how to maximize and take full advantage of all the applications available on your Macintosh. Right, welcome to IT Idiots, episode 39. I'm Nicholas Hill, Nicky Curtis with us once more. And this week we're going to be looking at something, well, I think it's going to be pretty exciting, actually.
I think so.
So you've not come across anything in a video terms of what we're about to do, have you?
No, what we're going to try and do this week is set up a virtual cluster with VMware.
There's no try about it, we're going to succeed.
We're going to do it, we're going to set up a cluster with VMware, which is going to be great for me.
And for a lot of people that use heavy into their VMs for demonstrating and things like this.
Exactly, and if you do a Google search, as I mentioned last week, there are ways of setting up a cluster, a Windows cluster we're talking about in VMware.
Yeah.
But a lot of them involve editing files, and this is the right way to do it. And what we're going to do is set up our cluster with a file storage to be on a backend SAN or NAS provided by OpenFiler, which you saw last week.
Yeah, we're not very good at editing files, are we?
No.
Cool.
Don't like that. So the first thing we're going to have a look at is the concept of clustering. So Nick, do you know much about clustering? Windows clustering?
I know about Honeynut clusters.
Okay, it's not quite the same thing, no. So Windows clustering, the idea of Windows clustering is, if we've got our mail server, I've got one mail server, if that goes down, well, I've lost my email. Okay, so what we could do is we could cluster it and have it actually on two machines, myself, my machine and your machine. Only one of them's active at any one time, but if that dies, the other one pops up and starts running.
That's great. Why don't we just use Gmail?
You could use your Gmail as a solution, I think some of you probably realise there are a few issues behind that.
Okay, I'm sorry, I don't want to belittle your...
So a few questions. So what we need to set up this high availability, well, let's do SQL, let's say a high availability database server. We've got a one SQL server here.
Something that, say, for example, runs your access cards to let people in and out of a building, that would be pretty...
Serious.
If that went down.
So what we would need to set up a SQL cluster is we need two physical machines. Well, virtual machines in our environment, of course. And you could use VMware clustering as well on ESX. And these two physical nodes I've just set up, and they're pretty much exactly the same. So for you guys in VMware, just use snapshots. That's all I've done, snapshots and clone from that. So I think that's the IP address there. And that's the IP address over here. .1.212. And one of them's going to be active. And one of them's going to be passive. So the thing is, they're both connected up to the real physical network, but to the real to the real physical network. Although they've both got their own IP address, 192.168.2.11 and 2.12, you'll be interfacing it with a clustered IP address. Mm. So let's just make up that clustered IP address.
That's left. You need to scroll left. It's not up. It's left.
Thank you. Accessibility options. What we do is we set up a clustered IP address, and that'd be 192.168.1.215, and that'd be the clustered IP address.
Fantastic.
Okay, so to set up clustering, well, you've got a bit of a problem really, because if you imagine our Exchange server is running on the one labeled A active, and then that dies, well, how's the passive one going to find out that that one's died?
Is it pinging it?
Well, with clustering, it is pretty much. There's a heartbeat between them. So let's use a different colour. Wow. What you do have is you have a separate network connection between... let's not use a separate colour. And that's referred to as a heartbeat.
Right.
So that's a dedicated network connection.
Heartbeat,
yeah. So they've got two network cards in. They've got one network card connecting to each other, and they've got the other one that's connecting to the real network, and that's the one you're communicating over. But so if that one marked A goes down, P is going to find out about it because it's not respond to its heartbeat, and it will start up the Exchange services and provide access to all the database.
Okay, now what's a realistic time frame for that to notice that the active one's gone down? And
well, it can check within seconds.
It is within seconds, okay.
Yeah. But there's still a bit of an issue here because the active machine's got to have access to the Exchange database or the SQL database. And when that dies, the passive needs to have access to it as well. So we need to have some kind of shared storage.
Now, another quick question. Sorry, I was just coming up with some thoughts. That IP address, would those IP addresses be masked? So it uses a proxy. So, for example, when I'm using Exchange,
and it connects into my small business server, and it's based on sort of IP addresses, and that now goes down. Is it using a proxy between those two?
I wouldn't plan on letting anyone know about those physical IP addresses, because the service it's going to be offering to the network is always going to be based upon its shared IP address, 215. So that's the one that's in DNS.
Okay.
That's the one that everyone's communicating with.
Okay.
But yeah, good point.
Well, it was just a question.
But it wasn't a good point. Okay, so what we do need is we need to have shared storage between them as well. And in old days, what you used to have is you shared SCSI bus game between them, and basically exchange data used to be on that.
Okay, I'm just not quite sure what you've drawn. But
that's SCSI going into a couple of hard disks and then coming back out again. Yeah, there you go. That better?
That's great.
That's better for you. Can of beans, red stripe. But what we're going to do in our little demo is, obviously there's a bit of a problem with shared disks in a virtual environment, but we're going to store our shared storage on our OpenFiler NAS box.
Which has been running really well for us all this week, hasn't it?
Exactly. So that's all going to be on there.
Fantastic.
Which is quite common. And the nice thing about that is, you know, for ultimate fault tolerance and accessibility, the OpenFiler storage, you saw us create it last week, it's mirrored.
Yep.
So everything's on that and it's mirrored. Again, the OpenFiler provides snapshots, so I can do revert backwards and forwards. And again, guys, you've got to be careful with that. It's not so easy to say, just go back an hour, go back 2 hours, because sometimes you mismatch with the configuration and the data.
Okay.
So it's not quite safe.
But that's why the virtual environment to try these things out is the perfect thing, isn't it?
Exactly. So if we can manage to set this up in VMware, what you'll be able to do is you can add Exchange onto it or SQL onto it. And again, I don't think many people have actually done this well.
We're pioneering.
This well.
We're exactly. Setting the...
setting the... Okay.
Everyone knows about ERMs.
So I guess a lot of you guys are going to be following through with this or setting up your own clusters as well. So all I've got is I've just got my one domain controller there. I've got two cluster nodes set up here, IHQCLN 01 and 02, and they're just created from templates.
Great.
Okay, they've joined the domain and I've added two network cards to them as well. So if I just look at the settings of this.
And we don't have to reinstall these in 120 days time?
Not at all, no.
Excellent.
Okay, I look at the settings on that one, and that's got two network cards as well. So they're all looking good.
All looking good.
So, now there's a particular way to actually setting up a cluster.
You did this last week.
What, log on?
No, failed to put your password in the right place or type it correctly.
So I'm just going to log on to these machines and let's just do a little bit of work in preparation.
So you've logged into basically three machines there.
Yeah, I've just got the domain controller up there and I've just got my two cluster nodes here. And what I'm going to do is just show you the configuration of the network cards. That's obviously quite important. Now you probably want to label these up. That one there, local area connection, is
internal,
connected to public. And again, I'm just using Microsoft terms here, and that's referred to as the private network. That's the Heartbeat network.
Ah, okay.
Now, the way I've actually set this up is kind of interesting. If we look at the settings of VMware and have a look at Ethernet, that one's just bridged. Ethernet 2 is connected to a LAN segment called Heartbeat, which is internal to VMware, so you can really emulate this.
Okay.
And likewise, in the same machine, it's got a similar configuration. Right, now what I'm going to need to do is, on the private network, I need to give it an IP address. Now these are the only machines that are going to be seeing this IP address. So I can just make one up as long as it's unique within my network. So I'm going to put 10.1.1.1. Okay, and again, I'm wasting lots of IP addresses there. You don't have to use a full set of 8 bits in there. So that's all set up. And I've actually... Sorry, I was clicked on the wrong one.
That's all right.
Let's put that to 2, because that's on the right hand side for me. And let's go back to this one. And we set this up to be... Guillermo.
It's getting warm in here. Fans are really kicking in all over the shop.
Yeah, fans are machines that run in quite a few now. Okay, and this one is going to be 10.1.1.1. 255 255 255, and that will do. And I should rename these. God, can you hear my stomach?
Are you nervous?
Huh?
Are you nervous?
No, I'm just not eating today.
Oh, okay. Is that because you had your Kentucky bucket last night?
I had a bucket of Kentucky last night. It was too much. Right, I was going to rename these things, but I can't be bothered now.
You're probably going to regret that later on.
I am going to regret it, so I will right click and
open that. So I can't hear you over your stomach.
No. And 10 pepperamis it had as well.
Oh man, were you on the toilet all today? Is that why you couldn't come round this morning?
That's why I had to be slightly later today.
Ah, joy.
So you really want to know this, don't you? Private, we said that was called. Public. Okay, so I've set up the two cluster nodes. They're part of the domain. The other thing we need to set up is a service account that the cluster service runs under.
Okay.
Now, the cluster account's got to be an administrator on all of the nodes in the cluster. Okay. Now, we're going to have two nodes in this cluster, but you can have 4, 8, as many as you want. But the laptop might not like
nodes on there. The virtual environment. You might need a Mac Mini to be able to run that.
Exactly. Right, so to remind you guys from last week, let's just have a look at open filer configuration and let's have a look at the shared devices. Because what we need to have is, we need to have a number of partitions shared between the two nodes. One of them is referred to as the quorum. Mm-hmm. Now that contains the SCSI, just think of it as the configuration, and you normally give that drive letter Q. And you can see I set that up.
So what does quorum mean? What's the Latin translation of quorum?
I can't remember my Latin.
Okay.
Not quorum. I remember the Lord's Prayer, that's about it. Right, quorum. So that was all set up. And I'm just going to look at the data volume, because I think all I need to do on here, we can see there, iSCSI, is I've just got to make sure that... Kiamo. I've just got to make sure that the network is able to use it.
Does it transfer data that briskly?
Oh, this is confusing me now. I'm going to have to full screen it. Okay, so...
Access...
allow. So update that. So that's the data volume. And I think I created data 1, didn't I?
Data 2.
Data 2. And these are all going to be shared. So I could put, for example, SQL on data or an exchange on data 2.
And what you put on data 1?
That's...
You created 3?
Yeah, Q's. 1's the quorum.
Ah, yes, of course.
1's the quorum, yes. Right. So that's allow. Let's go back to list existing volumes. Good, this open filer though, isn't it?
It seems pretty impressive.
And let's just go to data 2 and edit this. And just say allow that. So that's the shared storage sorted out. So we've got the cluster machine sorted out, the shared storage is sorted out. And the next thing we're going to need to do is actually install the SCSI initiator software on each one of the nodes.
Okay.
Which I did forget about.
And that initiates the SCSI, does it?
It does. It's the client part to the the SCSI part.
That's the thing we downloaded last week from Microsoft, is it?
That's the one, yeah. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to access via some admin shares, because it'll be a very quick way of getting that SCSI files across. And they will need to reboot, unfortunately.
That's no problem. I don't know what music to put to any installs or slow time we've got this week. Obviously, last week was great with Airwolf.
Did I do 212 there? I don't know what I called the other machine. IHQ CLN02.
Cedora.
And I'll just copy that across.
Okay.
Right, so what I'm going to do is just pop to these virtual machines, just install the SCSI initiator. Remember our...
SCSI?
One of our, was that school?
Ken. Was it Ken who used to call it SCSI?
SCSI. SCSI.
Or was it Clive?
No, it wasn't Clive. Well, I would have called it something unrepeatable.
He really would have, wouldn't he?
So the SCSI initiator software, this is just a free download. Just stick that into Google. And we need to put that on both the nodes. Don't know anything to do with the configuration. Next, let's just pop to this one quickly and do the same here.
So if you'd really prepped this, you'd have done two, no, pre-done two of them, and then just demonstrated it on one.
Just shut up.
You really got to work on your attitude. It's constructive criticism, you know.
So, right. So what we've got is, in setting up the cluster, this is where OpenFiler is going to be slightly different to reality, because one thing you notice with OpenFiler is both nodes can actually write directly to that file, which could give you some corruption.
Corruption, yeah.
When your cluster service is set up, it doesn't allow you to do that.
No.
So there's a special way, there's a special set of events we've got to go through to set up properly, and that is we set up one node at a time with the other one switched off.
Okay.
And if you always think clustering, when I first thought about clustering, I thought, well, Jesus, it's hard. And it's only until you actually do it and set it up that you think, oh, this is actually really straightforward.
Okay. You reckon Chubby could do it?
No. Not at all. God, no.
I feel so sorry for people that post about how great Chubby is as an idea, who've obviously just watched the first couple of episodes. Yeah, he had his opportunity.
Okay, so I'm just going to restart this machine here. And this will be the first node. So what I've got to do is, once this machine's actually rebooted up, is I use the initiator software, okay, connect to those shared drives. And with clustering, you normally start from Q for the quorum, R for the next drive, S for the next drive, etc.
Yep.
So I'm just going to let this reboot, and we shall configure those. Now, your shared drives, they can't be in dynamic disks. It's not supported. Oh, I don't need to reboot.
Sweet.
Cool.
Is that going to cause us problems later?
No, not at all. But what I'm going to do is I am going to follow best practices just by shutting this node down.
Oh, so we work on one node at a time, yeah, then shut that one down, and then bring the other one, yeah, back up. Okay.
So, first node, what we've got to do, now I don't know the IP address that you use for your OpenFiler, but the one we used was just 192.168.1.250. I'm doing okay. Now, onto targets, we should see the three drives there now. And we can see that's the quorum. Let's log on and say automatically refresh that when it boots. And I should do the same with the other two drives as well. Automatically restore when the system boots.
Cool.
So there's a few manual steps, which I don't think you would guess, to be honest. The next thing you've got to do is go into your drive manager or disk manager, whatever it's called.
And mount the things.
Yeah, and actually mount them and get them formatted. So if I go into disk management here, I should be able to see those drives. We saw this last week, didn't we?
We did.
I want to initialize those two disks. Yeah, that's
fine. But you don't want to convert them.
I don't want to convert them. So away we go. It's just popping to full screen. Oh, that scares me now.
It does, but it's telling you the window that you need. Okay, that's not a problem.
That's not
a problem. You can go full screen, just keep it within the dotted bars.
Okay.
We've got screen capture issues.
Okay, so disk one was quorum, wasn't it? So yeah. What we'll do is we'll right click on that and say... Oh, format. Oh, that was formatted from last week.
Ah, yeah.
Quorum allocation, perform a quick format. Yeah.
That's not your root drive, is it? No, because that would be disk zero, wouldn't it?
I'm going to actually delete that partition. And let's recreate from scratch on that one.
Okay.
So primary, happy.
Yeah.
This is going to be Q. Click on next, NTFS, quick format. And we can quickly just go to the others as
well.
You
did call it O, by the way.
Did I call it O?
Yeah, that's not a problem.
I can change that quickly. Q, and this one's going to be Nip.
Have you gone back and redoing it?
No, I'm just doing the other data drives.
I thought I was going to call it R, and you're going, no. I said I was going to call it Q. You're going so quick. I'm trying to learn, you know.
The last drive, new partition. And this will just be an S.
So why have you called them O, R and S? Surely it would be better to call it Q.
I will go back and recheck.
Bless. Oh. I think you're going too quick, aren't you?
I am, yeah. For these new things. Partitions, slow yourself. Primary, that was
take your time.
That would do.
R-S.
Next. Quick format.
Slowly.
Next. Finish.
Sweet.
So, we can see... Q. Hey.
Okay.
So that's all. That's just one node set up. So we've got Q, R, and S there.
So we need to. This would need to be repeated for the other node.
Exactly.
No problem. So we can do that, and then I think we'll do that. And probably just cut that bit out.
Exactly. What I want to do is that's just healthy, and I'm going to shut this one down. So what we'll do, we'll come back to this. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just going to do exactly the same on the other node. You can fast forward it through, but I'll shut this down.
Right. We back.
Yeah, we're back.
Okay.
Right. Okay, so the stage we're at is I've just booted into, well, I don't know if you saw in the speed up, cluster node 2, and I just gave it Q, R, and S.
Okay.
Of course, didn't need to format it, didn't need to do the partitions because the other one had done all of that, so it really was just pointing to it and giving it Q, R, and S. The next thing I did was just to make sure I got the drive letters the right way around. On node 2, I quickly in drive Q created a folder called Q, R, and S, and we can see on the first node that all seems to be fine. So, we've got our shared storage, we've got a heartbeat network between them. The next thing to do is actually set up clustering. Now, there's no add-remove programs or anything like that. Oh, jeez. All we need to do is go into Cluster Administrator.
Oh, great. So, we don't actually need to install some applications?
Nope. And it says, what do you want to do? Open connection to a cluster? No.
We want to create one.
Cluster. Yeah, we want to create a new one, or we can add nodes to a cluster.
So, I could do this, see?
So, create a new cluster. Click on Next. The domain that it lives in is lab.itdots.com. We call this one ihclue.
We can't call it Honey
S01CLS. The screen. The computer name that will be the first node is CLN01, and that notice that node is switched on. The other one isn't at the moment.
Okay.
And it runs through a few checks just to make sure that DNS is okay, make sure it's got the relevant files on there.
So this is the right approach. You do one at a time.
Exactly.
And then you add the second one in. And is that just a case of powering this one down and then powering the other one up?
Yep.
Or do you just power the second one on?
Just power the second one. The first one, when you create the cluster, if you're following Microsoft instructions, you probably can do it without doing this. But I always power off all the nodes except the first one. And what we're trying to do is save corruption on the shared drive.
Yeah, okay.
But when you're not using VMware machines, you can't normally write to the same drive anyway. Well, normally it's a configuration on the SAN or NAS.
That will prevent you
from
doing that. That
will prevent that from happening, yeah. Okay, so that seems all fine. Click on Next. The cluster IP address is 192.168. Remember, they do have their own IP address, but we need to have a clustered IP address.
So we're gonna give it one, are we? Or is it 250? It was the 250, but that was the one that we
I
created.
Can't remember. No, that was
that
the...
Was the
I'm going to have to go 175.
That was the NAS drive.
So yeah. There you go, 175. I'm sure I haven't used that one before.
I'm sure you have now.
Oh. Missed that one. And next thing, it's asking for a cluster service account. So I've set this one up, CLU service.
And is this domain user?
It's a domain user, yeah. It's got to be a local administrator in all the nodes, so I've just made it domain admin, because that's a local administrator.
Right, that's okay. Anyway.
Next. And away we go.
I was honoured, by the way. Somebody thought that I was the idiot that you were teaching.
Yeah, it has sort of changed. It was shabby originally, wasn't it?
Yeah, now I'm an idiot. It's great.
What do you mean now you are?
Thanks.
I'm sorry.
My stature in life is just... It's a little bit like the graphs, a little bit like the drawings you do. They sort of start top left and go down to bottom right. It represents my life. Ho-hum.
So what should we do when we've got this cluster up?
We'll break one.
Well, it's not really clustering anything at the moment. I suppose we'll put a file share on it. We could install SQL or something, but that'd probably be too long, wouldn't it?
Yeah, but I mean,
yeah, whatever.
Well, I was going to say SQL, but then I thought, no, you'll turn around to me and say,
well, I think if we get this cluster working, we'll put a file share on it.
Can we?
And that'd be it.
Can we cluster some torrenting?
Well, that's what I thought. You could cluster. I did think that, and I thought, no, I really ought to do some documentation.
How is your documentation? You up to date on all your documentation?
No, I hate documentation. You're not? No.
You got lots of it that you're sort of sweeping under the carpet?
No, not sweeping under the carpet.
heaven forbid.
Luckily, by the time this podcast is out, I might not. Because this is going to be out 2 weeks' time, isn't it?
No, I'll release this one first.
Okay, so that's all set up. And if I have a look at inside my nodes, let's see what active group this is running. It's running something called the cluster group. If we have a look inside active resources, we can see all of these resources are actually in a group called cluster group.
Yep.
And we can see disk R is in a group called 0 and disk S is in a group called 1. Now, I've only got one node in my cluster at the moment, which is not a very decent cluster, but the next thing we do is that we can add further clusters to it. And the idea is these groups can operate on either of the nodes.
Okay.
And they can immediately fail over.
So are we going to do that and then come back to that?
Yeah, so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to power on the second node.
Even though the first one's still up?
Yeah, the first one's still on. Because it's defined as a cluster now.
Okay.
And again, I'm following Microsoft instructions, but
okay.
You might be doing might have a quicker way of doing it.
So we'll come back to this once you've...
Yeah, it shouldn't be long. It should just be powering up. Because what I can do is go to Active Resources and say... I go to Resources, actually, and say there's a new resource, I think. New resource, and we'll give it a file share. Our resource name is file share. I'm just going to put it in cluster group for the time being, just so we can see the thing failing backwards and forwards. So I put a file share in the cluster. Click on next, and we can see who the possible owners of that file share. I've only got the one node in that at the moment, so it can only be on node 1. Click on next. And dependencies, which must be born line. So in order to do that file share, it's got to have a clustered IP address. It's got to have a clustered name.
I think it's got to have a disk.
You don't actually need the quorum for that.
Okay.
Right, the share name, let's call this test. And the path of it is going to be r:\test.
So because the machine hasn't powered up properly yet?
No, because I need to actually create our backslash test.
Oh, okay.
I thought it might create it for me, to be honest.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah, you can't... If I create a shared naturally through Explorer, it would just share it out on that physical node, but I wanted to share that on that clustered IP.
Okay.
So, what do you say?
Share test.
That's it. So if I pop back to cluster administrator and do a finish there now, it should be okay.
What were the things like the permission? I appreciate you don't want to cover them maybe in too much detail, but there was permissions.
That was just share permissions.
Okay.
Just standard share permissions.
And the caching?
Again, that's offline folder access. Nothing related to clustering there. It's all just standard file sharing stuff. So I've got my file share and that's offline. Let's bring that online now. Well, hey, that's online. Right, the next thing I'm going to do, let's add another node to it. I forget where I do this from. New node. Click on next. And the name of this second node is IHQCLN.
No.
CLN02. And it's running through similar checks there now.
Okay.
Whilst we're doing that, what I'm going to do is just start run. /192.168.1.175, wasn't it?
It was.
Okay, so if I have a look at the shares on the cluster, 175, I can see there's a share there called test.
Yep.
Let's create something new on that. Knackers. Right, so now it'll be, oh dear.
It was, wasn't it CLS?
CLN02.
Oh, CLN, yeah, no, it was.
I'm run that again, because I don't know if the second node was booting up whilst I was doing that.
Well, I thought it was up, though, if I'm honest. It was going so well.
It was going really well, wasn't it? What I'm going to do is just ping it.
That would be why.
Okay, so it seems we've got a bit of a problem with a second node.
no problem.
So I'm just going to log on to the second node and have a look at the IP address assigned to the second one.
Yep.
And you know what? I think the IP address is from your router, isn't it?
Router is given back.
Okay, yeah, so a slight problem here. We didn't get this on a static IP address, or you didn't, Nick. Right, 192.168.1.212. So you probably want to plan the installation a bit more thoroughly than we have. Doing okay. Okay there.
Would that involve some documentation?
Yeah.
Is that why we fail so miserably?
Right, I hope that's the reason. Let's click on next now.
Hopefully.
So I think this would be a good podcast, just to almost leave it this, setting up a cluster
without
delving into too much of the application side. So we set up the cluster. Again, it's asking me for the password for the cluster service, which you guys can probably guess.
Yeah, no, I think that'd be quite good, because to come back and do it justice in actually playing with it and using it later on.
Well, exactly. The nice thing is we set up a cluster, and with this podcast, you can base anything on this.
Yeah.
You'd better store Exchange onto it, SQL onto it. And I'll put the file share on it just so we can see the thing failing over. Because I want to, well, you probably realise, I'm kind of proud that the thing actually works in VMware, because I don't think too many people got this working.
No.
Without any hacks. And really what we're doing is really emulating a NAS box and doing it properly.
Which is quite cool. I know you were excited about it.
I was on Friday night, wasn't I?
It was good. I was busy, I was out partying, and you phoned me on my, kept phoning me on my mobile saying, I'm at home.
I go, look, I just need more nodes, I need more memory.
You were running out of, you were basically running out of machines and resources.
So, come on. Oh, I was going to sort out this share, wasn't I, whilst I was here? It's not let me do it at the same time. Yeah, what I need to do is, of course, the share permissions is everyone got read, so I don't have any permissions to write to that.
It's almost there.
Hold it on for a few seconds.
A little bit more.
Oh, it's a strong one.
Disk resources. It's great.
It's fantastic.
Tell us something amazing about this. It speaks for itself, does it?
It does, yeah. I'm just admiring the beauty of it.
Do you want a mirror?
That's RAID 1.
Oh, that's RAID 1, isn't it?
So we're being shunned upon by the edgy geek community, are we?
No. They were just saying that, you know, from their point of view, because obviously they're technically quite high up in the world of education, that it was perhaps a little bit lacking at times in the in-depth technical content. Well, I think this will stick two fingers up at anybody who said that.
Yeah, I don't reckon many of you guys would. Well,
let's not start a war.
Okay,
because it'll bring our website down.
Right, so I've got my two node cluster up. Let's just have a quick look through the configuration. If I look at cluster node one, let's have a look at what active resources are on there, so we can see they're all on cluster node one at the moment. Now, if I go to here, let's just... Oh, actually, I sort out the permissions on that resource. And file share. So let's go to properties of this. And just say, everyone, full control.
Okay.
And if I just...
Should be able to create your bitmap now.
Create a new text document. Okay, so I can create something. Now, I'm not quite sure what machine that's actually on, you know, because if you look, I'm actually accessing 192.168.1.175.
Which is the proxy.
Which is, yeah, I mean, you could call it.
Well, I would refer to it as a proxy. Perhaps that might be a misnomer.
Generally referred to as just the shared cluster IP address. So, let's say, oh God, cluster one, that's coming down. We need to put new hard disk in it, or, you know, generate your own exciting scenario there.
insert scenario.
And what we really need to do is just move all that across to cluster node 2. So what we can do is just right click. We can go in a group actually and just say, let's just move that group across, and I'm going to move all the other groups across. Oh, they've gone across as well. And now if I look at number 2, go to active resources, we can see online pending, online, so they're actually starting up.
Oh, it's failed.
And number 2, right, the reason why that's failed, you can probably, well, you might be able to work out why that failed.
Not me, I'm an idiot.
Let's go to active resources. What's happened, because it has failed, it's failed straight back again to the other cluster.
Right.
Now the reason why that file share failed, very probably, if you think about it, it's a dependency on disk R, isn't it?
Right.
So if disk R hasn't failed across, then that file share can't fail across.
Okay.
So if I add a dependency and just say...
So when I said it did require the disk and you said it didn't...
This key announces that with the file shares in the cluster group. Okay. And that's change cluster group. What I'm trying to do is just move this across to the same group as the
okay.
Change group, cluster group.
Yes.
And now if I pop to file share, go to properties of file share, dependencies, I should be able to modify this and say that's actually dependent on R.
Online. Has something got it open? If that makes sense.
Let's take R offline.
Yeah.
Don't give me any greed.
Damn you. Damn you to hell.
Disguise a dependency of file share.
Ah, do you need to remove it from file share before you then... It's not there to be removed. Is it part of the original cluster?
Oh, they're failing over now. See what's happening? They're failing back and failing forward. I don't know why that won't come online.
If you go to cluster name, is it part of that that you need to then remove it from there?
Dependencies on the cluster IP address. Okay. So disk R, dependency.
Can you see what it says dependency of?
There's no dependency on anything on that one. And the file share should be dependent on. Oh, there you go. That it moves.
Cool.
Cool, there we go. And we can see now that R has actually come online. There we go.
The whole thing's now online.
Yep, and the file share's online as well.
Wicked.
Because we've got the R. So the next thing to do, I suppose, is cut here. Notice that, oh look, 212. That's accessed. If we go back to 175 from here, not me. We can see what I've got a test in there.
Yeah.
Okay, and I've got access to the file. Quite clearly, if we go back to the cluster administrator, we can see that's now, you know, on node 2.
Yep.
Okay, so go back to active groups. Let's fill that back over. I think it's just happening a bit slow on this one.
Yeah.
And what you will notice as well is between cluster node 1 and 2, the QR and S drives will pop up. So back on here, although it hasn't really, it's a bit of a problem there.
But it's still failing over. There we go, it's back.
Back again.
Okay.
So that's our clustered file share.
Wicked.
Can we go now?
We'll put this to some proper use later on down
the
line.
Yeah, so I mean, I think the best thing about that, or why I wanted to go through that, is not really to show clustering, because I haven't really shown you much to do with clustering
about
at all.
How to set it up in a virtual way.
Because I think that would be really useful, certainly for people like myself. Now, yeah. I can play around all weekend, you know, I was going to go out and do partying and stuff, but I've got my clusters. I'm going to sign up an 8-node cluster in VMware.
Okay.
On a Mac. In Parallels.
Using Fusion.
Technology.
All very bleeding edge.
Right, you got my car keys, I'm going.
Excellent. No, well, thank you very much. So, there's nothing amateurish about what we're doing. So that's great. Thank you.
Yeah,
so,
presentation lacked a little bit, but hey.
But people did sound
really cool, and I'm happy with it.
People have got used to that now with you. So I think until next time, we shall say goodbye.
Bye.